This morning is from the Gospel of John in the 13th chapter. And Jesus and his disciples are about to celebrate the Passover, which Carnell just read, how we are to celebrate the Passover. There's very clear instructions. There's very clear understanding of how you are to do this. And Jesus is going to sit down in chapter 13, and he's not going to get up for quite a while. And we'll stick with Jesus in this room for the next 4 to 5 chapters, and he'll teach and he'll preach, and ultimately he's going to take what was the Passover, the ultimate sacrifice once a year, and end it because he will end all sacrifices and all needs of it. But before he does that, he teaches us what we're to do. The Jewish tradition has rituals and seasonal things that they are to do. Christians do as well. And this is one of them we'll find today. I'll read out of chapter 13, the first 17 verses. Listen for a word from our Lord through John. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And so, during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given him into his hands, and that he had come from God and he was going to go to God, Jesus got up from the table. He took off his outer robe and he tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and he began to wash the disciples' feet, and he began to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You don't know now what I'm doing, but later you'll understand." Peter said, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Well, unless I wash you, you don't have any share with me." Simon Peter says, "Well then, Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head." Jesus replied to him, "One who's bathed doesn't need to wash, except for your feet. It is entire, but is entirely clean. And you all are clean, though not all of you." For Jesus knew who was to betray him, and so for this reason he said that not all of you are clean. After he had washed all of their feet, he had put on his robe, and in return to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you're right, for that's what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, and you also should do as I have done to you." "Very truly, I tell you," Jesus says, "servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." This is the word of the Lord. I ran into a fellow pastor this week. They just looked a little bit off. I said, "What's going on?" "I'm frazzled, Ben." I sort of laughed to myself because I don't use the term frazzled very often. And so after giggling a little internally, but realizing that that might be mean, I said, "Tell me what's got you frazzled." Well, earlier I called a member of my church, and he texted me and said, "Can I call you later?" I said, "Sure." When I didn't hear from him later, I texted him back and he said, "I'll email you in just a minute. It's next on my to-do list." So I waited. Then I emailed him and said, "Are you going to respond before the meeting tonight?" And he said, "Sorry, I had to leave the office, but maybe I'll send you a Facebook message." And he said, I didn't know how we got to this point where we just keep communicating with the next form of communication, Ben. Everybody keeps telling me they have no time, and I'm frazzled." And I started to laugh with him because I knew it was true. And as I was leaving that conversation, I thought about something my grandfather said. "I wonder, when was the last time that you piddled?" My grandfather used to say, "Ben, you should piddle once a day." You should piddle because it lets your mind and your heart run wild and you are open to the creative spirit. My grandfather was a plumber, and he said, when you piddle as a plumber, you become the best plumber because people are keep coming up with new ways to clog those showers and toilets. I also thought about Lenny, who was a member of the church that I used to serve, and Lenny was, get this, a milkman back in the day. Lenny used to remind me that it was always good to go home at the end of the day, Ben, and be flabbergasted while you're sitting on the front porch, and you listen to someone else's story that starts with, let me put a bug in your ear, and then you respond at some point by saying, heavens to Betsy. That's what you need to do, Ben. He always told me you should have time for that, but now I don't have time to call or to text or to Facebook or to email. We don't have time to sit on the front porch anymore, do we? We don't have time to chase that rabbit again, do we? And then we read this story, and Jesus stands up at the table. You can almost see it if you close your eyes. He stands up at the table. He removes his outer robe. He puts a towel around himself, and he begins to pour water into a basin, and then he starts to wash the disciples' feet, and that takes a lot of time. And if anybody in the history of the world can say, I don't have time, Jesus is that one. He is about to die for all of us, and he doesn't have time to be doing this. But he takes the time to scrub and to scratch all of that, we'll just call it stuff, that's accumulated on each of his disciples' feet. I can't say this for certain, but I'd imagine he had to go back to the water basin to pour a new fresh pot of water, don't you think? That was some dirty feet. And I'd imagine that it was an incredibly awkward experience for the disciples. Anytime you take that much time, it gets awkward. It's not the foot washing part that's awkward for them. That's normal. Everybody wore sandals, as Carrie was talking about earlier, and there was dust and stuff everywhere, and your feet were the most important aspect of your body because they literally carried you from place to place, and so washing them was a normal practice. In fact, when you would come into someone's house, it was a sign of hospitality and welcome to have your feet washed. But it was a slave who did it. It was a servant. It was a child. It wasn't the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, the Savior of God's people. You didn't know the person who washed your feet. You could sort of keep talking while they washed your feet until the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, the Teacher of all teachers, the Savior of God's people started to do it. And so we begin to understand Peter's reaction. It's visceral. That's not a job for a savior, he wants to say. You're better than this, Jesus. You should be using your time wisely. You should teach. You should preach. You should perform miracles. You should be riding on a beautiful horse and to take over Jerusalem. What are you doing washing my feet, he wants to say. It takes time, Jesus reminds him. If you want to be a part of my ministry, if you want to be a part of my kingdom, it takes time. And so Peter, always looking for a little extra, says, well, if you're doing that, just do the whole body. Let's do this. Let's make it a whole cleansing. If you're going to wash some of me, wash all of me. But Jesus reminds him, Peter, you've already been baptized. You've already been ritualistically cleaned. This isn't about being baptized. This is about learning what it means to be a servant of God. And that takes time. As Jesus even tells them, you don't know what I'm doing right now, but later you'll understand. It takes time to remember. I think we're being called to remember foot washing. And I'm not really sure, but I've spent a good bit of time this week wondering, when did foot washing cease to be a practice in the church? We probably got too busy. Too many emails, too many texts, too many Facebook messages. People didn't have time anymore to personally wash each other's feet. They probably had to get home to piddle or to sit on the front porch. I'm sure there's a very clear understanding somewhere in history where they started to say, you know what, this is a really awkward experience. So we probably stopped doing that. As someone pointed out earlier in this week, even the adage, it's better to give than to receive, doesn't really apply to foot washing, does it? Because it's about the same to give and to receive when it comes to foot washing. I wonder if it was because we started to bathe more regularly. You can read the history of the human race and we started to use showers and baths more regularly. Or I wonder if it became more fashionable to wear shoes. I know I care a lot about shoes, so maybe that's it. Or I wonder if it was when we started to care more about what our feet looked like. And also when we realized that the new porch sitting was actually going to a salon to get our toes and our hands manicured. I wonder if there's a practical side too. We started to care for our feet better and there's less calluses. And so when someone else touches your feet, it might make you giggle because I'm really ticklish under there. I also wonder if we started to think people can pull themselves up by the bootstraps, they might as well take care of their feet too, right? Then there's the logistics. Ask any parent, any grandparent, if you've raised children, getting water, a towel, and a basin is incredibly messy. Somehow, some way, more water ends up outside than it does inside. But I'm trying to bring foot washing back. Jesus told us very clearly in this text, we are to do this. And as much as we can fight and argue about what Jesus did and didn't say about other things in Scripture, he said to wash one another's feet, right? But even this, and I'll admit it, even this is a pretty awkward thing to do, even in ministry, right? Sometimes it's hard, and you all have expressed this to me, and I've expressed this to you. Sometimes it's hard to say, can I pray for you? How hard do you think it is to say, can I wash your feet? I don't even think this falls into that last line of every minister in the history of ministers' job description that says, and other duties as assigned by the session. It's not in there. But I want to bring it back. I really and truly want to bring foot washing back. And when I was ordained, a gift that a minister gave me was a foot washing porcelain basin and a pitcher. They make those. Yes, they make those. So I put it in my car this week, just in case, right? Maybe the situation would present itself and someone would say, yeah, you can wash my feet. And it almost did. This past Wednesday, we worshiped in this space, and I stood right in front of the communion table on the sacred sanctuary floor, and I said over and over, from dust you came, and to dust you shall return. And it was this beautiful moment where I was looking out the peripheral vision of my eyes, and each time I said those words, I saw something. I saw brothers and sisters in Christ grinning from ear to ear as they watched everyone else receive the ashes on their forehead. They were watching, and I think they were smiling because they were watching the youngest and the oldest of our community of faith receive a cross that reminds us there is this incredibly thin line between life and death. And in that moment, time stood still. We didn't want to be anywhere else. We didn't need to be anywhere else. We weren't piddling or sitting on the porch shooting the breeze, but I think we were communicating again. Because the thin line between life and death was literally right here. You could see it. It was visible for everyone to see, and it made us smile because we don't need a cross on our forehead to know that there's a thin line between life and death. Just turn on the news. But what we do need to know is that we are not staring at that line alone. That everybody else is staring at the same line together. Now, my wife will tell you that I love to push my luck sometimes. Now, I've been thinking about this text from John's Gospel for about 4 weeks. I love the foot washing experience. I've done foot washings before, and they're so powerful. They're incredibly powerful because they're so disarming. Your feet, nobody wants to be that vulnerable, but when you are, you come face to face with your vulnerabilities. And I also firmly believe you become face to face with God. And so I told her, I'm going to find a way to do a foot washing. I knew Ash Wednesday would be this beautiful service because it always is. It's a time to stand still. And so I thought about pushing my luck. Remember, I am determined to bring foot washing back. And I was close. I was this close. I brought out my basin, and it was hidden back here. You didn't know this. And I had this, and I hid water right over there that nobody knew was there. And I actually hid water behind that because I thought, I don't know, these people's feet might be really dirty. They might need extra water. And then I had a towel. And Lydia called me earlier in the day, and I was out of breath. And she said, what are you doing? And I said, I can't tell you what I'm doing. But what I was doing was practicing, tying it around my waist. So I looked like an expert when we did this. And I kept telling her, we need to do this foot washing. And she said, every time you've done a foot washing, Ben, you've given the kids and the people fair warning. True story? But the element of surprise is what makes Jesus' display of affection and humility so powerful, I kept telling her. Then she looked me straight in the eyes and said, I love you, but the last time I checked, you aren't Jesus. Well, ain't that the truth, right? As my friend Lenny would say, I just thought that idea was a dog who could hunt. I didn't do it. I didn't take this out. I didn't want to place Maundy Thursday, which is what we're celebrating with the foot washing, on Ash Wednesday. I didn't want to ruin that. I didn't want to take away what was a beautiful service, but I was close, y'all. I was so close. But I took some time, and I lingered after that service, and I went back to my office, and I started putting everything away, and I thought, I'm just going to take this, because you never know. On the way home, somebody might say, I need a good foot washing. So I put it in my car, and I turned on the radio. And I had been really busy all day, and I hadn't heard about what had happened in Parkland. And I thought about driving down there and washing their feet. Because I was afraid that I think we're becoming numb to the words guns and debates and politics and school shootings and mental illness. And I'm afraid that those words are losing meaning because they have names and faces and stories attached to them. And I wanted to remind myself that they have meaning. And anytime you ask somebody to wash their feet, it jars you out of your normal way of thinking, does it not? I can guarantee you, no one has asked you to wash your feet in the last week, right? I'm not going to give up on foot washings. Because it takes time to pour water and to put your foot in there and to not tickle because it's hard, right? It also takes courage, and it takes a whole lot of faith in the one who told us to do it. The same could actually be true of the one who's going to get their feet washed, right? It takes time, it takes courage, and it takes a whole lot of faith. Jesus never said in here that it was going to be easy to follow him. He just told us to do it. He just told us to do it, to take the time. Now, maybe we're not ready for the foot washing, and I totally understand that. So maybe we just start with a cup of coffee and a lot of time to piddle. Maybe we start by reclaiming the porches of our lives where nothing is mattering, and we carve out time to chase rabbits down the rabbit trail and shoot the breeze. And then over time, I think we'll get to the point where this will be more normal. Our Lord calls us to do it. Amen.